Welcome to another video of Football Behavior Management. My name is Joost van der Leij, and today I want to talk about the FBM club model. Club of modeling is part of system thinking. I think that thinking in terms of systems works really well in football. Of course, football is quite knowledgeable about working with systems because they use different playing systems on the pitch. 4-4-2, 3-3-4, 4-3-3, to name a few systems. But system thinking is much broader than that. Actually, a lot of organizations in the US and also more and more organizations in Europe are using system thinking as a way of organizing their business. So, today I want to talk about system thinking in terms of football clubs, and the idea is to show you that you can optimize the way your club works by introducing system thinking. And an important part of system thinking is to actually have a model of your own organization in terms of football clubs, a model of your own football club. So the FBM club model is primarily a model of how your club is running. So there are three main principles that we use for the club model. That is, first of all, it has all to do about risk management. Running a club is quite difficult because normally risks are quite well known. Risks are very limited and there are a lot of ways to counter risks. But in football, it's so much depending on how the first team is performing to know whether the club is performing well. And that means that the 11 players on the pitch, if they make suddenly are making a lot of mistakes, then you have a big problem on your hands, but it is very difficult to manage that risk. Even the best teams still have a lot of mishires, players that they hire that basically don't contribute to the team. So actually running a club is quite difficult because there are big risks. And they are quite difficult to counter. So one of the main ideas to limit the risk is actually to make sure that what you do in the club is actually based on science. The big thing that makes science so important for our society is that it limits risks. The more you're science-based, the better your club will work and the less risk you will take. And finally, make sure that you always work from the principle of evolution and no revolution. Even if you have very revolutionary ideas, the ideas might even be great, but introducing them to the club, if you do it too radical, can actually destroy the current workings of the club. And even though the ideas might be great, if you implement it through a revolution, most often it is only more negative than any improvement. So we want to make small steps to improve the workings of the club. So if we look at risk management, risk is quite easily defined as the probability times consequence. So if you look at the most important risk for a club, that's relegation. Often the chance to be relegated is very small, but the consequences are huge. So even though you have a small probability, given that the consequences are so big, you still have a big risk. I did not mention it, but if we look at it, we're going to talk about Leicester today as the example. This is a presentation that I actually did the last week for a Dutch club, which we hope are going to adapt the club model. But I transformed it to Leicester, so that we can look at the kind of things that they are looking at to limit risks. So here we see, based on the average points that Leicester scores in the Premier League, how big the risk is to be relegated for Leicester. And you can see that here, you have about 35 points, that this small triangle is actually the amount of risk that the probability that Leicester is going to be relegated. It's very small indeed, but again, the consequences would be huge, so it's still a big risk. Currently, Leicester is doing it very well, so this is also quite important to take into account. Because what you see a lot is that when clubs do very well for two or three seasons, then suddenly they drop back. And the reason why is because they think that they're much better organized than they actually are. So Leicester is now on par to get a very a lot of points this season. So that means that they actually the chance of getting like 70 or 70 plus points is this little triangle. And that means that, again, the chance of that happening, the probability of that happening is really small. And it could mean two things. It could either mean that Leicester is is performing a lot better or scoring a lot more points at their current level of their team performance justifies, or that this graph is or this graph is outdated and that in reality it's much more to the right. The reading these graphs is very easy. The more to the right the graph is, the better it is. So we can have two situations. Either Leicester is doing much better in the table than the performance of their team would justify. And then we will see that in the coming months that Leicester is going to drop back, drop a couple of places in the table. Or this is an outdated, this is based on outdated information, on outdated data. And in the future, we will see that this graph is going to move to the right. So that then the probabilities are more in line of what we are actually seeing in reality. So this is how the club performs. But if the what happens is if the club does really well, is that the decision makers in the club start to overestimate how good they are. And then they're going to take more risk than they actually can deal with. So it is also always good to remain humble and always check for, okay, are we actually using the best system to run our club? And this is for the team, team performance. It also can be done for players. So if you look at these two players, Jensen's Under has been hired this season. It's not doing very well. And Gonzalo Plata, the rumor has it that Leicester is interested in. So this is the data of Under based on the previous season, so when he was still playing elsewhere. And this is Plata in the current season, is also not yet playing at Leicester. Sorry, this is Under and this is Plata, my mistake. And you can obviously see that it is much better to hire Plata than Under. The probability here, you have actually the number of FBM score points that the player can get, and the higher the better. And you can see that Plata has a much better distribution of probabilities than Under. Because that's another important thing, is if you look at, for instance, this. This is based on the average number of points that Leicester wins in a season in the table. And it's what the Poisson distribution does is basically distribute 100 percentage points in this graph. And then show you, okay, the probability that you get 40 points is this part, that you get 60 or more is this part. But it's also a very important lesson, because people often think in terms of probability as a single number. The chance of getting a heads and when you flip a coin is 50%. But it's much more better. It's much better to actually start thinking in terms of distributions. How are the probabilities distributed? So this is what you can see here. The probability distribution of Plata is much more favorable than van Under. In fact, the chance that Under will outperform Plata is extremely small. One thing, again, the more to the right these graphs are, the better. You can ignore the fact that Under has a higher graph than Plata. The higher graph is purely a mathematical effect, because there's the more to the left there are, you have less space to actually distribute the 100 percentage points. And that means that if you have to distribute the same number of points in a smaller area, then automatically the graph will become higher. So in fact, the lower heading of the graph of Plata is also an indication that that Plata is the better player. So then we come to sciences, and we're actually going to use 5 different sciences, but we're going to use some of them in a limited way. So first of all, we started complex system science and new science, I think 2 or 3 years ago, started for dealing with complexity. And that's also what the club has to do. The club has to deal with the internal complexity and external complexity of the environment, the future. The whole risk management system is basically a system to deal with the complexity in our society and in football and the club. We have the viable system model. It's the main model that we're going to talk about here today. It's a viable system model. It's a model of how organizations that are viable, and viable means that you exist for like 3 to 5 years. And Leicester exists for much longer, so Leicester's absolutely a viable organization. And every viable organization follows the system of the viable system model, although most of the time it's a very unconscious way of following the model, and it's often organically grown in the organization, in the club, rather than rationally thought about it. Then the cybernetic Big Five theory, that's basically how our brain operates, or the evolutionary behavioral patterns of our brain are described by cybernetic Big Five theory. And we'll see that the viable system model is a system where that works recursive. You can zoom out and zoom in into different parts of the organization. And if you zoom in, and finally you get an individual human, and then you actually have to deal with his or her behaviors. And then cybernetic Big Five theory is one of the main ideas to deal with it. And you deal with the behaviors that are basically people inclined to do from birth on, based on how their brain is constituted, the kind of brain cells the brain has. Organizational behavior management is also for the individual human, but then at the level of behaviors that are learned. We're not going to talk too much about it, but that's also quite an important part of the whole system. And then finally, Bayesian statistics, you already seen some of it. This is all based on Bayesian statistics. So we can calculate rather subjectively how a player would do for Leicester in this case. And then we take into account where is he currently playing, what is the strength of the league, and what is the team that he's going to play to, which player is he going to replace. All those factors, how many minutes did he play, we all put into a Bayesian model, and the Bayesian model is going to predict how well he will do at the club. Again, our Bayesian model, based on the data of the previous season, would have negatively advised for Jensen Under. It was extremely unlikely that he would do well at Leicester. Oh, one final thing that might be interesting to know is that I actually teach all these 5 systems at the Aubrey Daniels Research Institute for Behavioral Analysis at the VU University of Amsterdam and also at the Erasmus University of Rotterdam. So this is all mainstream science. It's new stuff, but also very good stuff that is very helpful for organizations and clubs. Complex system science, we only use a very small part of it, only this part. Basically, they say there are 3 prerequisites in order to be able to deal well with complexity. That is, you have to be able to scale, you have to be efficient, and you have to be able to adapt to new and different circumstances. All 3 of them can be easily explained in terms of football. Scale is also quite easy to understand, because if you have a team that only consists of individuals, so we have 11 players on the pitch, but they don't work together, they just only do their own thing, the probability of those 11 individuals winning from a well-formed team where all players work together is extremely small. We all know that in order to have success on the pitch, the team has to work together. And again, you can scale it up. So first 2 players have to work together. Player with the ball has to understand that he can try to rush forward and score on his own, but it's much better if he's actually able to play the ball to one of his teammates. So then you have 2 people playing together. And then you can basically scale up to, if you introduce the third man principle. And then you say, okay, no, you don't, we don't want to work in twos, we actually want to work in threes, so that the opponent has a more difficult time defending, because if player A always passes to player B, then it can much easier be intercepted. But if player A actually has a choice between playing to player B or player C, then it's much more difficult to defend against those three players. So again, you see, if you scale up and you have units of three players, football becomes easier for the team. The team is better able to deal with the complexity of the game, and at the same time, it becomes more difficult for the opponent. And then you can, of course, keep on scaling and to have more and more principles, more players working together until all 11 players are working together. The same goes for efficiency. It's also easily explained. You have a lot of teams, especially in the Dutch Eredivisie, that always pass to each other, but really don't gain any ground, let alone create chances. And that's a very inefficient way of playing. And those teams will lose most of the time from teams that are much more efficient, that are basically very efficient in passing and then very efficient in creating chances and actually scoring. The team that does that most efficiently has the biggest chance to win. And then finally, adaptability is also important. Things can change on the pitch. Actually, you can have a whole opposition research and actually prepare the team for a specific way of that the opponent is going to play. And then, for instance, if it's 4-4-2, and then when you're on the pitch, you notice, oh, they're not playing 4-4-2, they're playing 3-4-3. So we have to change our behavior, we have to adapt. And the better you are able to adapt to unexpected circumstances on the pitch, the better the team will do. So these three, skill, efficiency and adaptability, are very important for football on the pitch, but they're also very important for the club as a whole. And that's what we're going to talk about next. So don't be scared by this complex picture, but this is the viable system model of Stafford Beer. And you can see everything from the club. This is basically the whole club, this part. That's Leicester, but it's also Ajax, and it's also Liverpool. And here we have the environment, the competitors, but also the future is there in the environment. And then we have to zoom in to the different parts of the viable system model. To begin with, the first team. So this is actually the first team within the model, and is the second team, if it's a viable team. I won't go into the details of what it means to be viable as a team, but at least the first team is viable. And then in this circle, you have the actually players of the team, and in this box, you have the staff of the team, including the team manager. These are the players, and this is the staff, and then we have, and this is called System 1 as a whole. And this is the staff of the first team, is also the junior management. And here we come on to cross on the first lesson of the viable system model. That is that even though the team manager often feels that he is the boss of the whole club, in fact he's the junior manager, according to the viable system model, and the viable system model is right. Because here we have the senior management of the club. System 3, that you can see here, is basically the daily operations. The CEO, they run the club in order to make sure that the here and now is run okay, and the internal organization is running fine. And then you have here System 4, which is basically the senior management part that is responsible for the future and the relations with the environment. And they basically consist of the technical director, the sporting director, the scouts and stuff. And they have to make sure that the whole club as a whole is prepared to deal well with the environment, other clubs winning the league. But also with the future, so that we will also have the right players for next season and the season after that. And then finally, we have the type of the system 5, which is the basically the final decision maker. If there's a board of non-commissioned directors, then it's the board. If it's if there's an owner, then it's the owner. And they basically, they don't have to do anything. Their main job is basically sleeping. They only have to wake up if the system 4 and the system 3 can't come to an agreement. So basically, the daily operations says, no, no, we have players enough. We're going to do it with this system. And the system 4, the technical director, the scout, says, no, we need new players. This is a great player. If they can't come to an agreement, then here someone has to step in, either the owner or the board. And so that's how it works. As I said before, it's a recursive system, so you can actually zoom in and zoom out. So if you would look here, you have a very small circle, that could be the keeper. And then this little square here is then actually the staff for the keeper, basically the keeper trainer. And they would form their own unit, and then the keeper trainer would be the junior manager. And now the team manager here is the senior manager for this unit. And the same if you have your defender and defense trainers, field trainers, that is all you can zoom in. And if we would zoom in even further, you can actually see there are little boxes here as well. You can zoom in further, then we can come to single individuals. And once you have a single individual, then you'll also have to use the cybernetic Big Five theory that I'm going to talk about next. At the same time, you can also zoom out if you want. You can also say, no, this is not Leicester as an organization, but this is actually the English FA, the Football Association, and then this is Leicester, and this could be Liverpool. And we could even zoom out furthermore, say, no, this is UEFA, and this is the English FA, and this is the Dutch FA. And then again, then if this is the English FA, this would be Leicester, this would be Liverpool. So you can see this is a system that incorporates skill in a very good system, in a good way. You can basically zoom out all the way to the FIFA, or you can zoom in to an individual player or an individual member of the staff. So this is how every club is working, if it's a viable club, in the sense that they exist longer than 5 years. But most of the time, nobody has thought about these things. It's grown organically, and it is quite useful to actually use this model to actually chart the whole club, to make sure that everybody knows which role it is, and to start thinking about, okay, once we know how this has organically grown within the club, can we now think about it rationally and see if we can optimize the whole system. So the viable system model is quite useful for football clubs. Especially for this question, what's the balance between autocracy and autonomy? Because basically, the more responsibilities you give to the senior management, the more autocratic or dictatorship the club is becoming, and the more you give autonomy to these units, the system ones, the more freedom you get and the more autonomy. And there's a simple rule, is that nowadays that the complexity of the modern world is just way too high to have an autocratic system. If you are a dictator, you have to decide everything, you have to know everything, and there's just way too much knowledge, way too much issues that you have to deal with. So the only way to run a modern organization is to give the system once more autonomy. At the same time, there is some kind of irony going on, because the team manager, he feels that he is very autonomous. And that means that he feels from his autonomy a lot of power. And that means that he often wants to make decisions for the system 4, which can be a choice. But then you have to make the team manager basically the sporting director or the technical director. And then he can decide everything. But it makes the club as a whole more autocratic. Because nowadays, the moment you say, okay, the team manager is going to play a role at this level. We're going to listen to him as to know what kind of players does he want, which players do we hire, and which players do we not hire. Then you start making the club more autocratic, and the club becomes less able to deal with complexities. a really smart team manager would understand that and say, no, I want to have my own autonomy. I'm only going to focus on this system, and I'm going to trust the senior management to come up with the right players for me. So both models work, but the first model, the autocratic model, is much more has much more difficulty dealing with complexities than the autonomous model. Then we have cybernetic Big Five theory. There's another video of football behavior management where I go into very whole detail of the whole model. So please go to YouTube to our channel and watch that to get it explained more. What I want to do now is just show how those three things, the scale, stability, and scale, efficiency, and adaptability are part of the system. It actually reminds me that I talked about how scale is in this system, but I did not talk about how efficiency is just in the system or adaptability. It can be very done quickly. The daily operations for the here and now and the internal organizations, they are responsible for the running the business as efficient, or running the club as efficient as possible. The system four, the scouts, the technical director, the sporting director, they are responsible for the adaptability of the club. They have to make sure that they develop the club, whereas they, system three, the internal daily operations, are responsible for running the club. So again, you see that the viable system model adheres to the prerequisites of the complex system science, skill, efficiency, and adaptability. But the same goes for our brain. Our brain does all those three things, because basically there are three or four major things: stability, exploitation, autonomy, and exploration. Now, here we have already autonomy again, in the same way that we had the system one that was here, autonomous. But now autonomy is put against or across from stability, and that is means social stability. Stability here means social stability. And again, this is what skills. So social stability is important in order to be able to work with bigger teams, work with more people. So most people in the club need to score, in the way of the brain type works, score high on social stability. If there's not enough social stability within the club, then the club is going to fail. At the same time, we want also to be able to scale. We want to scale up to work with bigger and bigger groups. But we want to be able to scale down to get to more of the individual level of players. More of the individual level of staff members. Because if you have too much social stability, then the club is going to stagnate. If everybody is always agreeing with each other and there are no new impulses, then the risk is that the club is going to stagnate. So in order to prevent that, it's important to have a couple of people who are quite, they score high on autonomy. And because these are the people, they work antagonistic. Most people score high on agreeableness, which is basically easy to agree with people. Antagonistic are people who are more eager to fight, make problems. But it's a good thing, because if you have too much of this, then you stagnate. So you need a couple of people who are score high on autonomy, because they can create new goals for the club, and they can create new strategies for the club. Whereas the social stability people, they basically take a current goal, but it can be a big goal because they can work together with the whole group, and they will use existing strategies. If you have too many autonomous people working in the club, then you have too little social stability, and then people don't work together and the club will fail. Exploitation is the part that works for efficiency. And that once you have the big goal and found which are the strategies to achieve that goal, then the best thing to do is to make sure that you run those strategies as efficient as possible by basically exploiting what you already know. But again, if you have too many people in the club that are only basically exploiting what they already know, then the club becomes too rigid. That's why we also need exploration. If we need a couple of people to explore stuff. So the people who explore stuff are basically making sure that the club has a lot of adaptability, because they're always looking to see if they can find new goals in the environment or in the future, or find new strategies to achieve those goals. So there's an interesting difference between exploration, which is finding new goals and finding new strategies, and autonomy, which is basically creating new goals and creating new strategies. Both are important because sometimes environment doesn't provide new goals, then you need not autonomous people, and sometimes the things that people come up with doesn't work, and then it's easy, better to find new goals and strategies. So you can see we have scale between autonomous individuals and the social stability of groups. We have efficiencies in terms of exploitation, and we have adaptability in the form of exploration. And you can also translate this to the pitch, because social stability is what's needed for defending. If you try to defend against an attack of your opponent on the pitch as individuals, that will be very difficult. So to defend is really a group activity, and you need social stability to in order to achieve that. But if you attacking is much more an autonomous activity, that is much more where you have the creative moment, the creative impulse of a single player that is making the attack work. Then of course, if you have defended well, then you have to start scanning to see if there are openings, to see if there are options, goals that you can try to achieve, new strategies that you can use to actually get into a scoring opportunity. So that's where scanning is very important. And then once you have scanned the pitch and you know what opportunities are there, then you have to exploit those opportunities by passing well. So again, this whole model is how our brain works. There are 9 different brain types, and depending on your brain type, you're better at one thing than another. And this works well for the staff members in the club, but also once you are have this whole staff adapted to this system, then it becomes also very interesting to learn the brain types of the players. Because most brain types work well together, but some combinations need extra guidance to work well. And you can see, for instance, if you look at Ibrahimovic failing at Barcelona, mine theory is that that has mainly to do that his confrontational, short-term rebelling, disinhibited behavior, basically he was in this area, worked quite badly with Barcelona, who was very much into social stability. So knowing the brain types of your staff members and then knowing the brain types of your players is going to help a lot when you want to optimize the way your club works. Then very quickly, because I'm not going to do much with organizational behavior management, this is the whole protocol that organizational behavior management uses. There are 7 steps. The first step, specify desired behaviors, undesired behaviors. We did it for players on the pitch. That's how our Bayesian model works for evaluating players. Then measure the behavior and also measure the predictions. And this is the one I want to talk about for the club model. That is quite important that you have all the people in the club who are part of the decision-making process, which player to hire, to actually quantify how well they think the player will do in the club. So if you go back to the difference between Plata and Under, this is my subjective feeling of how well Under and Plata will do in the club. And you can say, well, we can say, okay, this is about 60 points to 20 points. If you want to have a single number, would be a little bit better if you do actually in terms of distributions, but to keep it simple for all the staff members, then basically ask them for a single number between 1 and 100 of how well the player will do, and then actually start to measure how well they predict things, so that you actually can see, okay, these are the people who are the best at predicting and the people who are less good at predicting. I'm going to skip the other steps, they are quite important, but if we take evolution and not a revolution into mind, then introducing everything else for organizational behavior management at the first moment might be a bit too much, But they are all quite important to make sure that the other steps of organizational behavior management are also used. But I'm going to skip it for now. And then finally, we're going to use Bayesian statistics to actually to do four things. Predict. We want to be able to predict stuff and explain, because a lot of data in football, it suggests that it explains, but then you can see that the correlations are too low, and then actually people are fooled by randomness. They think that they understand how football works based on the data they gotten, but given that the correlations are below 80%, a correlation below 80% has very little information in the data. So people often think that there's much more information than there actually is. So if we want to explain stuff, we want to understand how it works, we want to make sure that it's based on high correlations. But we also want to make sure that we use to predict stuff. So football data that doesn't predict, I always find quite tricky, or I say not tricky, but suspect. It's looking back is so much easier than looking forward. And even though I already explained that if you look back and you have correlations below 80%, then you're really not looking back at all. It's way too muddy below 80% to call it looking back. But looking forward is even more difficult. But you want to use the forward-looking things to limit the risk, of course, but also as a check to see whether the system that you're using is actually working. We want to make sure that you use Bayesian statistics. Why? Because Stafford Beer in the viable system model already explained that once you're going to make you have decisions to make, you're going to take new actions, you implement new protocols, stuff like that, the system 4 always has to calculate what the impact for the club will be. And the only way to calculate, there are different ways to calculate, of course, the impact, the risk assessment and risk management. But Stafford Beer, already in the 70s of the previous century, discovered that once you use the Bayesian statistics, that calculating the impact on the organization works much better than if you use the frequentist statistics. So that's the reason why we want to use Bayesian statistics. That is part of the viable system model. So let's look at what we currently calculated. For Leicester, the Premier League is currently, from all the leagues that we actually did the calculations for, you can see which leagues our clients are. They're much more in the lower leagues than currently in the Premier League. It's quite interesting that the Premier League is currently the strongest league according to our calculations. And the interesting part is that we only use the data of individual players to come up with this strength. So there are no weights, there are no match results, there are no don't look at the budget of the clubs. We don't use anything at team level, so it's a completely bottom-up system where we only look at the individual actions that all the players in the league make, and then we're basically putting all those actions into a Bayesian model, and the Bayesian model is telling us how strong a league is. And then you can see, you can have a very natural way of organizing leagues completely based on the actions of the individual players. The same goes for the table. So here it's not the actual table of this moment. It's based on the current, so this is Christmas. It's not Christmas, it's in Boxing Day in English. So this is Boxing Day 2020. We use the most recent data, and based on that data, Chelsea should be number one according to our model, Liverpool number two, but the difference is really small. It's sorted for the overall stat that we calculate, and you can see that Leicester is actually doing, according to our data, much better than expected, but that we already knew, because we can see in this graph that if you look at the average number, that average points that Leicester scores in a season, then again they are doing much better than expected. So you can see that according to our model, there is a bit. Those three are very much at the same level. Chelsea and Manchester City are basically underperforming currently. Leicester is overperforming, if our model is correct. So it will be very interesting to see how the coming months of the Premier League develop. Because if our model is right, then you'll see Leicester drop a bit and Chelsea and Manchester City rise a bit. But it could be that we have to adapt the model, and that if you put all the player data in from the coming months, that it's going to go more into the way the current table is organized. Importantly, if we do it as backward looking to understand what is happening in the Premier League, there's an 86% correlation with the rank and an 80% correlation with the point. Normally the correlation with points is higher than with the ranking, because the ranking is really a linear function and the points are a little bit less linear. But somehow it is now the other way around. If we've done this for the Dutch Eredivisie currently, and there our descriptive correlation is 95% with both points and ranking. So that means that either the Dutch Eredivisie is much developing much more, it's much better to understand, less weird things happen in the Dutch Eredivisie than in the Premier League, or that our model needs to be updated. We're going to see it in the coming months. And more importantly, there's a predictive correlation of 80% with the final table. Of course, it's not this data, because we don't know the final table yet. This is on previous seasons, and we've got an 80% correlation with the final table. Again, you can look at the individual players, understand how Leicester is doing. You can see that according to us, we only have two star players, Vardy and Castagne. Castagne is a good signing for this year. Evans still doing reasonably okay. But you can also look at different aspects of the game. So if you look actually at defending, then you can see that more players score well. So basically a red is bad, yellow is average, blue is good, and green is exceptional. There's a bit of a problem with the passing game of Leicester. Attacking is quite difficult, so it's quite understandable that there are not that many good attackers, although for the second place in the Premier League, I would have expected a bit more, and defending goes really well. So again, all this data is based on the individual actions of all these players. If you calculate all of this, you get these numbers. If you let me make it a bit more clear. If you put all these numbers into our Bayesian model for the team performance, you actually get these numbers. And if you put all these numbers into our model for league strength, then you actually can get this number. So it's all based on individual actions. No team information, no match results, nothing at a higher level is put into the model. And the reason why we do that is quite important, because we want to make sure that we can actually explain that if we say that Plata is going to do better than Under, that we can actually show, and that's actually what we do for clubs, we can actually show which numbers Plata would score for Leicester. That would show what playing with Plata on the pitch would do for these numbers. So then you can actually show to clubs that depending on which players they hire, how that would translate into closing the gap between the top three teams in the Premier League, if we're talking about Leicester. And then finally, we have something called replacement values. This is the value, the amount of pounds a club has to expect to spend to replace a player. It's basically we use this data, of course, and then we combine it with minutes played, the team ranking, the length of the player, the age of the player. So basically, Schmeichel is of course a very good goalkeeper, but if you want to replace him with someone of the same level of performance, so we want to have these numbers, then we are saying that we can find for Leicester a good replacement for 2.5 million, a little bit more than 2.5 million pounds. If you would have to replace Barnes, then you know, you have to look for less than about 25 million pounds. And normally we would calculate it for three different clubs. So we would calculate it for the current club, in case of Leicester, for Leicester, and for the next club. So if you look at Plata, we would calculate the replacement value of Plata for Sporting, where he's playing now. Then the replacement value for Leicester, how much would it cost to replace Plata for Leicester. And then we would calculate what would be the next club. In case of Leicester, that's not really important, that final thing, because the Premier League is at the top of the apex of all the leagues. So that's basically the end station where players finalize their career and have the last clubs that they play for. And so if Barnes would go, then basically if he would go to Liverpool, Liverpool would be smart to value him at about 30 million pounds, Leicester about 25 million pounds. So if, as long as Leicester gets more than 25 million pounds for Barnes, Leicester is doing okay. And if Liverpool would pay less than 30 million pounds for him, then Liverpool would also be okay. So if you look at transfer fees, which is different from replacement values, because transfer fees also have to take into account how many years is his contract, what is the market circumstances, how badly does the club want the team have. That's why transfer fees might be much higher than the replacement values. But for Leicester, if they want to sell Barnes, they have to make sure that they get at least 25.5 million pounds. If Liverpool would be the buying club, then Liverpool would have to work hard to make sure that it would be below 30 million pounds. If they would pay 40 million pounds, that would actually mean that Leicester would become stronger, because they certainly have 50 million pounds on top of their replacement value that they can use to get even better players. And at the same time, Liverpool will become less strong because they have spent 10 million pounds in a way that does not replace value at the Liverpool. So, especially when you also have the current club and the replacement values, then I think the system of replacement values really works well when you're negotiating with clubs to transfer players. We've done it in the Netherlands for Dalmau. We predicted a replacement value from 1.75 million, and he actually was transferred for 1.7 million, so only 50,000 euro beside the point. We used these calculations to help Willem II to in their transfer of Frans Sol to Dynamo Kiev. It became much easier for Willem II to accept the proposal that Dynamo Kiev had for them when they saw that the replacement values of the Frans Sol were much lower than the value that the Transfermarkt gave to Frans Sol. And we used it for Kortrijk to calculate the transfer fee for Papa Gouillet, the player they hired this year from Norway. And the asking price was 2 million, and we showed that it should not pay more than 600,000. And actually, I don't know what the transfer fee has been, but I do know that without us calculating it, the transfer would not have happened. So thank you for watching the FBM football of FBM club model. Hopefully you found it very interesting, and when you want to talk about the club model for your club, please feel free to contact me, and we will make an appointment to see what the club model, how it looks for your club. Thank you, and hopefully we speak soon.